Songs of Insurrection is a 75-minute piece by Frederick Zhevsky from 2016. And what he does is he takes seven international songs of protest from all over the world, and he takes the theme and kind of, in a very Zhevsky way, writes a fantasy pseudo-variations on each of these themes. Each one's about 10 minutes long, so the piece is in seven parts. And I find that when I'm playing it, I love to draw the connections between each of the songs, the way Zhevsky does in his music. And you can hear how really all of these songs of protest are connected. This piano is insane. We're recording this piece on this incredible fazioli, which is right behind me here at the Colburn School at Zipper Hall. This fazioli is one of the most beautiful and exquisite instruments in the world. It is taken care of here by Nima Pezargad, who's the technician here at the Colburn School. And I've always been a huge fazioli fan my whole life. I've recorded mostly on faziolis, and this instrument in particular is so delicate to every muscle movement your hand makes, from the softest of softs to the loudest of louds. Really, whatever you want to make, this instrument behind me can make that sound. And for me, it's the perfect instrument for this piece.
Zhevsky is one of those people who wrote some of the first pieces that really convinced my generation of composers that we could really speak powerfully and clearly into politics. His mentality about just, you know, the music should be free, giving it away. Of course, you have the first major variations, "The People United Will Never Be Defeated." And I'm seeing, actually, as a composer and as a conductor and as a recording engineer, all sorts of impact of that music. I think that the special thing about Zhevsky, the thing that I keep coming back to in his music, is the idea that, you know, we're not just making notes. It's vital and deeply important to, you know, speaking into and recording what it means to be alive in 2020.
What's special about this piece as well is that each movement gives the pianist the option to improvise a cadenza or not. And for me, I have elected to take extended improvisations in the movement 3 and movement 7, or part 3 and part 7, and smaller improvisations in the other movements. I think it's important to Zhevsky and the Zhevsky sound in that his music really comes from this world of improvisation. And as a pianist, I want to capture Zhevsky. I want to also filter it through my brain and through my hands and my voice, and I find that those moments of improvisation is where I feel most connected with the music and most free to express myself.
Yeah, so recording improvisation is a really, I mean, you're talking about a number of different things there. So of course, you go, I mean, such a thing maybe begins, or we think begins, with jazz and albums like Kind of Blue, where you just think, oh, well, this is just the first take of each time that they played something. When you're making an album of such a piece in the classical tradition, you have this feeling that you're trying to also construct something which fits and works with both the composer's and pianist's vision of the piece. I think that the interesting thing here has been that when you have time, you're able to kind of get into the improvisation and make suggestions. So we were just recording the improvisation that takes place in the fourth movement, and Thomas and I were talking about a very tiny corner of the improvisation that he plays, where he plays a particular melody in octaves, and whether or not that interval is really the right sound to come out of into what Zhevsky writes coming out of the improvisation. I think it's a really interesting and fun topic, because you can push it in all directions. You know, you could just sit and play for many hours and then cut something together, or you can have a really preconceived notion.
I would say when it comes to improvisation, I definitely feel on those extended ones kind of nervous about it, because my goal would be to get 5 minutes of perfection, that there's no cutting, there's no editing, there's no dropping in a second improvisation inside of it. And so when I'm playing there, I'm trying to remain present and just you know, making up the music, but at the same time, I don't want to get too far away from it and then get out of it and then have to go, oh, no, I have to make a cut right now. So a lot of it's just about being present, being in the moment, and really trying to capture what it's like just to perform the piece for an audience. So on day one, we arrived here and we're setting up all the microphones and we're setting up all the things and sound checking, getting the piano right, and Nima's in here tuning the piano. And of course, as any recording session goes, we're running into a few problems. There's a buzz in the line of some of the cords, the cables, and then we start hearing a hum in the room and we're going, well, what's that hum? Oh, it could be the air conditioning. So then they cut off the air conditioning. And then, no, we still hear something. And then Aaron suggests, could it be the lights? So then, of course, we cut the lights off. It's pitch black in here, and it was the lights. So for the first time in my life, I've had to record now the rest of this piece in complete darkness. I've gotten two stand lights, which I put on the Fazioli, and I have my iPad light, and otherwise the room is in pitch black the entire time while recording this piece. At first it kind of threw me off and I was like, I can't quite see the same way, I can't see the keyboard. But then once I kind of sank into it, I really started to enjoy it. You know, you get in this space, this big hall, and it's all dark, it's very intimate. All you have is you, the piano, and then a small speaker on the right, you have Aaron talking to you and giving you his input on the takes. So I've kind of actually grown to like being in the dark.
We are in a beautiful hall with an absolutely amazing piano, but probably the difficult thing that we've got here is, of course, it's also a busy working hall. There are concerts all three nights that we're recording. So we're getting in the morning, putting everything up, setting all the microphones in place, getting the piano there, making sure it's tuned, plugging everything in, making sure it works, and then recording. And normally that kind of happens on the first day and you spend a couple hours doing it and really, really tweaking the sound and getting it right. But here we do that, and then at the end of the day we spend half an hour just tearing everything down like madmen and running it across the Colburn School and sticking it into Thomas's office. So, you know, we've done everything. I don't know if you can see the microphone stands behind me, but we've taped the height of them, we've marked every little thing on the floor, you know, where every single thing is, the piano is, the lighting states, the temperature in the hall, all of those things, trying to recreate the sound day by day.
What struck me about Aaron most of all was, one, he's an incredible composer and writes an awesome music, but he's a conductor and his ears are some of the best ears I've ever met. And right when we met, he was just starting out his career as an engineer, and I just respected the way he heard music, the way he led the musicians in recording sessions, and to me, he was the perfect match to lead me through this amazing piece by Zhevsky. Thank you.